Hello, everybody. Once again, Understanding Bigfoot, Mike Scott with you. And as we record this, we've got Susan Perez here, my partner here in Cape with the SEMO Bigfoot Encrypted Research Group, the leader of that group. And Becky Pepper is with us again, co-hosting of North Texas. And Becky, the show we did last week with Jay Wilson was released this morning on YouTube, Bigfoot in Atlanta. Keep your eyes open, the title of that. And already that has...
I just saw that earlier.
Really gained a lot of traction. A lot of people seem to be enjoying Jay's enthusiasm and energy as he talks about his findings and research this summer in the suburbs of Atlanta. So we're glad to see that. And tonight we're going back. We've got our old friend Tom Cantrell with us. And Tom has done a couple of programs with us, very successful programs. And we've got a very special night tonight, Tom. We're going to talk about the new book that you've got coming out. Last year, we featured Sasquatch Face-to-Face, and now this one. I think everybody that's interested in Bigfoot will want to watch this show and maybe get this book because it's called The Proof. The proof is out there.
See what it is.
And Tom and I talked on the phone the other night about this, and there's some new stuff that... That they have discovered. And Susan, Becky, let's welcome Tom to the show.
Tom, welcome. We're so thrilled to have you on again and can't wait to hear about your new book.
Welcome. Welcome, Tom. I have been reading this book.
Have you? Oh, okay.
And I've been enjoying that book, so I can't wait for the new one.
Thank you.
Well, don't buy it. Hint, Becky, don't buy it.
you can give it to me for Christmas.
Be your Christmas present.
That sounds good.
So we just remove the doubt right now and get that one out of the way. So.
I started that book out just with an idea of taking all the evidence that's been available that people just, well, that's old hat. I don't want to talk about that. What's new? What do you got for me new, you know, type thing. The YouTube warrior is cry, you know, what have you done for me lately? And so I started with the jury crew incident in Northern California back in 58, which was what got me started.
I was going to say that, if I remember correctly, that's what got you interested in this.
Yeah, it is.
Let's repeat the year again. 1958 is when Tom started on this journey.
And what got me interested, one of the premier mammalogists in the world at the time investigated this case. Dr. Ivan T. Sanderson had written like 13 books on mammals, and they were the standard of the world for any professor, any doctor of mammalogy to use. The man was well regarded in his field, and he came to Northern California, did research on that, and published some articles of his own, one in True Magazine, one in Argosy, and others, but those two, and they're still available if you search them out. They're on YouTube if you do enough searching. And that got me interested. That got me started. And then, of course, the Patterson-Gimlin film. And I was reading, just today, was reading something where the film was mentioned. And here's people still talking about, well, that wasn't true because Roger Patterson stated on his deathbed that he'd made that all up and it was a hoax. Well, that's a lie. That never happened. Okay. But people hear that from their brother-in-law or their friend of their brother-in-law, and they take that to heart. Okay. You go to the fact that people like Bill Munns, who ran the school for creating costumes for the movies, took that film not only frame by frame, but layer by layer of emulsion in the frames and examined it. And he has an absolutely brilliant exercise with it on YouTube called Bill Munns Reports, and he'll show you exactly why, even if you had a suit that was built that way, you couldn't find a person that would fit in that suit. Mm-hmm. Just as a very quick, what did our head do from our eyebrows up? It goes straight up. Patty's doesn't. From her eyebrows, it goes back. Mm-hmm. So you build that head with the eyes where you are to see out, and your head won't fit in it. Okay? That's just number one. The legs won't fit. The arms won't fit. The body won't fit.
Right.
Nothing will fit if you had, even if you had the material to make the suit with, which John Chambers won the Academy Award for Planet of the Apes in 1968, said, if they built made that suit, it's the greatest one ever made because we did not have the materials in that time to do that. That suit does, that image does things that you could not do with a suit. Mm-hmm. Every hair would have had to been individually placed. Now, his Planet of the Apes costumes took like 8 hours to put on. It was an all-day affair just getting those things on and right. It
took the actors 8 hours to wear those, to get those costumes on.
And they had no movement, okay? None of the muscles moved.
Right. That was the state of the art at the time, too, because that was a box office hit.
That's right. So. Okay, now you're going to tell me two cowboys from Yakima area in Washington are going to go down there and build a suit? And do something Hollywood couldn't do? Right. Not likely. Mm-mm. Okay. Right. Now, that's just a couple of things. But we went from there and talked about that. And then there's an anatomical constant that I have been preaching for almost 15 years. And it's called the intermembral index. And what your intermembral index is the ratio of your arm length from your wrist to your shoulder to your leg length from your hip to your ankle. All primates have a specific intermembral index, IMI. And we humans, it's 72. Our arms are 72% of the length of our legs.
Now, does that vary a little bit? Because I'm just going to ask, because you'll see some basketball players seem like they have a little longer arms than others.
Let me tell you, plus or minus 3%.
Okay.
But that's the center of the bell curve. And then 1% standard deviation for each standard deviation. Okay. Now, that was the next question. I had that. So somebody said, well, what about a person with gigantism? So I pulled up a picture of Andre the Giant, remember the wrestler.
Yeah, right.
Wrestler, 7'3", 7'4" tall. Did the measure of him. His IMI, 72.
Wow.
Somebody then said, well, what about dwarfism? So I found a picture of dwarf. Did the measurements on it? IMI was 72.
Wow.
That's incredible.
Mm-hmm. Now you take a gorilla, the IMI is 120. Their arms are 20% longer than their legs. Chimpanzees, it's 105. Their arms are 5% longer than their legs. Sasquatch, 84. Okay. So then what I started to do, I took films, standard films that we've all seen and argued over. First one was, do you remember the Marble Mountain footage where the group of high school or Boy Scouts found a structure and then looked up on the ridge, on the crest of the ridge, and there was a creature walking down the ridge and shaking his hand at him? I did that one, 84.
Right at 84.
Right at 84. I did the Independence Day footage. If you remember, she's behind some rocks. stops and picks up a baby.
Picks the baby up and kisses it.
Yep.
Yes.
IMI 84.
Wow. That's so, that is so neat.
Now, yeah. I'm just going to, Susan, I'm sure you have heard, I've heard people that claim to be experts in this area try to debunk that Independence Day footage time and time again, is saying it's fake. But if they faked it, they made the arms at 84% and faked it, right? You know, so how I tend to agree with Tom on this one.
And the hands work,
yes,
the elbows work,
right,
and they're in the right place. So how do you fake it?
See, if you fake it, you have to have an arm extension on that, which takes your fingers out of the hand and your elbow out of the elbow.
And not only that, but it removes the elbow.
Right.
In order for me to go from my 72 to an 84, I have to add 4 inches between my shoulder and my wrist. Okay. Now, if I just use an extension that moves the hand down 4 inches, now my elbow is out of balance.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay. The only way to do that would be to put 2 inches here and 2 inches here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And that's not going to happen short of surgery. And I'm not about to sit around and let them do surgery on me.
People aren't. They're not getting sawed off for to fake that's something,
right.
Are they?
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay. I did the Harley Hoffman video. Sasquatch walks behind a tree and walks out 84.
Wow.
I did the NVTV video. Shows the one walking across a basin by a tree. 72. Matter of fact, everything I've ever done that NVTV put out is 72.
That doesn't surprise me. Yeah. matter of fact, I quit clicking on it a couple years ago.
Yeah. But I had to do that. Okay.
Yeah.
Now,
but interesting that I mean, you also, not only have you found the 84s, the authentic videos that are out there, you also found some of the hoaxes out there at the 72.
That's right.
So
you remember the Jacobs film from a few years ago?
The one in Pennsylvania where it's bending over?
Yeah, right.
Yes.
Where it argued whether it was a bear or a Sasquatch.
Right.
IMI was 100.
Oh, so it's neither.
It's a bear.
So that is bear.
Yeah, a bear is perfect. Yeah, their front legs are exactly the same length as their back legs.
Wow.
And
interesting.
So, yeah.
Because I would have thought that was too thin in the girth for a bear.
Yeah. I think it was had health problems.
Right.
Perhaps.
It looks sick. Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. It looks.
But it definitely IMI'd out as a bear. So
cool.
That takes all the guesswork out of it.
Oh,
not
yeah.
Not only that, it takes a anatomically accepted standard as something that's taught in Anatomy 101 in every college in the country is that intermembral index. Okay. That removes it out of the realm of guess or should have been or would have been and puts it in the arena of science. We now have something that's reproducible, irrefutable.
Right.
What has always been held up to us as the problem with our evidence.
Right.
It's not reproducible. Now it is.
Mm-hmm.
I'm
sorry. When you look at something, how would we look at a photograph and measure to get the percentage?
Well, you can see in the book, it'll show you. But basically, I use Microsoft Publisher.
Oh, okay.
And put the picture in there and then draw arrows to cover the links. Then copy the arrows and make them, because his arm may be bent. So you'd have one arrow going this way and another one going that way. But you can take those then and align them, and then you can measure them.
That's way above my pay grade. I'll just read the book.
That's what I'll do too, Susan.
Well, hopefully.
I was thinking of taking a tape measure to the computer screen, you know.
Well, no, it doesn't matter as long as you can get a good measurement. But you've got to be able to determine where that shoulder point is, where the hip point is, where the wrist is, and where the ankle is. Those have to be, you know, you have to have good vision on those. That's why Paul Freeman's film, I haven't been able to do that one yet because I can't get a good enough frame. Mm. The Memorial Day footage I can't do because I can't get a good enough frame. I keep looking. Somebody's going to do one here one day that will be. It just takes it out of the realm of guesswork and puts it into the realm of science.
Right.
That figure, those computations would be admissible in a court of law in any court in the country.
Right. The first thing I look at when I see someone post a picture, I belong to a lot of different groups, but I only post things that I feel are credible, mm-hmm. or maybe someone can have an opinion. But the very first thing I look at is the comparison of the arms in relationship to the knees.
Mm-hmm.
If they're way, way shorter than the knees, I don't know if I'm correct or not, but I tend to think, no. That's not right, because their arms should come down pretty close.
Right.
To that.
Two prime examples of that. Back in 1998, I think it was, BBC was going to do a show that was going to totally debunk the Patterson-Gimlin film.
Oh my
They
goodness.
Spent tens of thousands of dollars on a suit. They put this person in the suit, and I have a picture of him side by side with Patty's picture and the person in the suit. Number one thing you see is when he looks back, he does like, if you turn or look back, you don't have to move your shoulder at all. Our head sits up on a pedestal, and right. we can rotate around and look right over our shoulder. Patty can't. Mm-hmm. Okay, I don't know whether they have less vertebrae or they're just shorter. I mean, a giraffe has the same 7 neck vertebrae we have. They're just a little bit bigger, okay? But when she turns her head, her chin is into her shoulder, and she has to open her shoulder to look back.
Whole upper body has to turn.
That's right. And see, with this figure, it did not. Then I did the IMI on it, 72.
72.
Wow.
Great.
Yeah. They spent $20,000 for a suit and got nothing.
Yep.
Even BBC, after it was over, said at the end of the show, said it actually did nothing to dispute the film.
Right.
And it's just like every other effort to discredit that film only ends up in proving it more.
Right.
First of all I need to do is talk to Bob Gimlin.
Right.
There has never been a more honorable, upright, truthful individual in the world than Bob Gimlin.
Well, through television and all the different documentaries and programs that come out in the last 15 or so years, I've heard Bob tell his story probably 20 different times now. And the thing with that is it never changes.
Never.
Never changes never. One bit. His details are always the same.
He was with a filmmaker one time, and this was reported to me by a news reporter for Yakima newspaper. He was with them, and this camera person or film producer got a phone call from a major, let's just leave it at that, a major Hollywood producer. And the guy says, "You're not going to believe who I'm sitting here having lunch with right now." And they're, "Well, who's that?" He says, "Bob Gimlin." He says, "Right now, and I guarantee this, I will hand him $1 million cash if he'll tell me how they faked that film."
Oh.
Bob says, "Well, gee, I'd like to take your money, but what happened was we were riding up the creek bottom and came around this root wash, and they're on the opposite bank."
Told the same story.
Absolutely the same story, told the same way. And there's $1 million laying on the table.
That's crazy.
And yeah. Also, you've got to remember, Bob's he's an old time cowboy.
Right.
Okay. He and I both have the same attitude there. What they say about him and what they have said about me 150 years ago, they'd have been shot.
Right.
Yeah.
Took another class.
Yeah, you did not impugn a man's word.
No.
And Bob, I mean, wasn't he was a rodeo guy and things like this. You know, he's a tough old cowboy.
Well, he was still breaking and training horses four years ago.
And he just turned 91, correct?
Yeah, yeah. He finally had a wreck on a mule, and his wife told him one more cold on this place to break, you're going to have to find a new home.
Oh, my goodness.
I told him probably not a whole new number, but it would be in care of the doghouse. But even then, he'd go down once a week to the Historical Society there in Union Gap, just a little town next to Yakima. If you remember the singer Gary Puckett in Union Gap,
well, yeah, that's right.
That's where he was from, Union Gap. Okay, and taught people how to drive horses, how to hitch up teams, and such like that. That was up till COVID hit.
Wow.
Doing that.
I've never met the man. He had to cancel the year that I was in Kentucky. Mm-hmm. But he is so genuine, that comes through. There's no way that, mm-hmm. I don't understand how people could think that gentleman is not a genuine person telling the truth.
Because they're lying, or they want it to be a lie, and they won't accept anything. You know how that works. Exactly.
Yes.
I offer these arguments, and they have no way to refute them. Mm-hmm. First of all, they don't know what they're talking about to start with it.
Right.
But somewhere their brother-in-law told them something, and so that's the truth. And you know, facts be hanged. That's you know.
Well, I think in my experiences, Tom, and I think Becky would probably say the same thing, is that we know so many people, Susan probably the same thing, even you, they just don't want to accept that these are out there. Mm-hmm. And they don't want to accept that because they've been conditioned not to accept it all their lives.
That's
Now that more and more viable proof and the credible sightings and eyewitness accounts with the social media is skyrocketing. Mm-hmm. And people are just in so much denial over that. Let's shift gears a little bit. We're staying on the subject about the proof, and let's talk about, you and I talked the other night and kind of doing a little preview on this program. Your work on the sounds, what you got.
Where we're going next.
Okay.
But,
now we'll have to continue, talking about Bob, hopefully with Bob sometime, but I know that's going to be difficult.
I'd love to meet him. That would be exciting.
Yeah. Becky and I will keep on until you get him on here.
Yeah.
Well, you need to come out for the Yakima Bigfoot Con next year, and I guarantee you'll be there.
Well,
and that'd be one perfect way to get it done.
Okay.
But we're talking about sounds now. If you remember Ron Moorhead,
right?
Ron had he and Al Berry got the tapes of the Sierra sounds of conversation. Now, I don't know if you've heard yourselves that howl that they do at night. Mm-hmm. It's a, oh.
I've heard it in person.
Okay. you're talking about Mr. Wilson from Atlanta area. There's a place down there where we camp just east of Atlanta. Actually, it's only a few miles from the Alabama border. And I just love laying there at night and listening to it all night long back and forth. But I always thought that was like shooting a flare. I'm over here, you know. Hmm. Okay. Thinker got a hold of that and did spectral analysis on the audio on that. It's unmodulated. There is no classified animal that emits an unmodulated howl. Not wolf, no cat, not coyotes, nothing in nature other than that one call.
What about a human voice?
Nope, it's modulated.
It's modulated as well.
Yeah.
By modulated, you mean up and down.
Yes.
Is that correct? Up and down, there's variation.
Yeah, okay. If I could show you pictures, I could show you the
right.
The waveform.
Yeah, I'm seeing it on the graph.
They're in the book. Okay. You got the idea to slow that down. Now, if you remember, with the Sierra sounds, when Scott Nelson, the cryptolinguist, started working with that, the first mm-hmm. thing he had to do was slow it down 50% before he started getting a morphine stream from it. I mean, by morphine, well, you're an English teacher, you know what I mean. You start hearing syllables and individual
right.
syllables.
Right.
Okay. He had to slow it down by over 50%. And I'm sure Sean could back me up on this too. When you look at our voice in an analysis spectrum, it's, you know, up
and down.
And up and down, up and down, up and down. Okay. When you take that howl and slow it way down, it looks exactly the same way. That isn't a flare. They're holding a conversation across distance. Okay. Now, you've got that. You take the Sierra sounds, slow them down, and put them on spectral analysis. Same thing. Take my voice, put it on spectral analysis. The only difference between those three waveforms is the speed.
Wow.
That's interesting.
That's amazing.
So now we have reproducible, verifiable, irrefutable scientific evidence of an unclassified being living in our woods.
That is so exciting.
And with that lack of modulation, that rules out anything. Well, right. That's a coyote or that's a mountain lion. Nope. That rules it all out.
It rules it all out.
Wow.
A person who knows what he's doing can take a spectral analysis and tell you what the animal is just by the way it looks.
Wow.
One more thing on the Sierra sounds. There are notes there that span single note that span 5 octaves. There's no human in the world can do that. Okay. There are humans who can range across 5 octaves. Mariah Carey, for example.
Right.
But they can't sing a single note that spans 5 octaves. This being can.
A human, like you mentioned Mariah Carey, they could maybe do one and then do another and be a different octave,
but they cannot do that on the same one. Yeah, but one of them will not cost
right.
5 octaves.
Okay.
Wow.
Okay.
Wow.
That's amazing.
Now you see why I'm excited about this book?
you're not the only one, I'll tell you that, because they're, you know, and that's the, you know, maybe come hopefully our goal, I guess your goal, maybe the new gold standard in evidence when you start getting this information out to the public and challenging.
I don't think it'll ever go to the public. It'll go to our public.
Right.
But the public will never read it. They'll never.
Yeah. What about the public that, you know, what our job would be then as ambassadors, I guess, is to go to our nearby, the three or four people that we talk to on a daily basis and said, oh, it's all fake. Oh, it's all phony.
Yeah.
And hey, you know,
I don't bother with those people. It was Eleanor Roosevelt said many years ago, we would not spend so much time worrying about what people thought if we knew how little they actually do.
Right.
Right.
Well, I'm not saying bother with them. When you get to the family Christmas dinner and they talk about this kooky Bigfoot brother and sister.
You know, I had my own sister one time said, why do you spend so much time doing this? I said, listen, Diane, I've had a being that 90% of the world does not believe exists hold my hand.
Wow.
What would that be worth to you?
Exactly. Oh, my goodness.
100%.
That gives me chills. Mm-hmm. That is so neat. Well, the thing is, with my family, I have a son and daughter, and I have two grown grandchildren, and then a 9-year-old grandson. Mm-hmm. And they don't doubt what I tell them. My daughter told mm-hmm. me on other issues, because I was a great conspiracy researcher and mm-hmm. UFOs, and then I got into Bigfoot and everything. And my daughters told me, Mom, everything you've ever told us has come true. So they tease a little bit, but they mm-hmm. when I tell them something serious, I'm so blessed to have them believe, you know, that I have learned this and to share it with them, and they don't make fun of me, because I told them, if you want to stay in the will, you will. You know, and I always say, I'm going to take you out of the circle of trust first, and then I'm taking you out of the will. So mm-hmm. what my daughter-in-law goes with me on all these things. She's about 5 foot. We need to get her on, Mike.
Oh, I'd love to. Yeah. And believe me, they want to stay in Susan's will.
where there's a will, there's a don't.
Yeah. Hers is the circle of trust. You know, they get outside of that, mm-hmm. they're in big trouble. But and the thing is, I posted something on Facebook. I think you liked it, Tom. Is that there is no amount of evidence that will impress an idiot. And some people are just idiots. But they're not only mm-hmm. idiots about this subject. And I hate to say this, but since I grew up, I've seen society just kind of dumbed down. They're not interested. They don't want to know the truth. They don't want to think about something that they don't understand. And I think that whole dynamic plays into what we're looking into.
Exactly. It really does. You know, and that's one of the negatives of the internet. People who heretofore, prior to the internet, in order to be heard, had to stand on the soapbox in the park, now right. have a ready-made audience.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't have to have any brains to turn the computer on,
right?
And there's a bunch of them out there just mm-hmm. like that, and have never had a thought of their own,
right?
And like I said, what I was reading today, it was just people. Well, so and so said,
yeah.
Where's your research?
Right.
So and so said doesn't mean a thing, yeah. Right. Like I said, my original premise was to get a conviction in any court in the land as to them being real.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I've long since decided never do I ever want them proven to government or science.
Right. I agree.
That'd be the worst thing that could happen to them.
Mm-hmm.
Just look at our government's record with indigenous peoples.
Oh,
and
right.
tell me you want that for anybody.
Very true.
No. That's absolutely true. And I see so many people say, oh, I want to prove it to the world. And I tell people in our group, very few say that, but some people, you know, put that down as a response. You know, I would much rather have a relationship. I know they exist. I've never seen one. I haven't had the interactions that Mike and Rebecca have had. They better hurry up because I'm getting older every year.
You gotta come out more with us, Susan. You gotta come out more with us.
You better let me know. I have to do hair and makeup before I go
not
out.
Not before you go out. Not before Susan, you go to the woods.
When you go out the woods.
Wait.
Oh no! Well, I have to have my makeup on. I don't want them to be afraid of me. You know.
That's so, right.
But I love going out there. I have some issues with my leg and my ankle and all this stuff. But I just think that is one of the most fascinating things I could ever experience. And I would want that for everybody, but I'm not wanting to prove that they're real. I know they're mm-hmm. real. Like you said, it held up in court of law.
Yeah. I want those who want to know more to have an avenue to know more.
Okay. Right.
And I'm working with people on a daily basis that are learning, and that's their goal. Okay. Mm-hmm. When I went, I know people go out in the middle of the night and bang on trees and scream in the night. And I tell them, if you want to bang on a tree back or scream back, do that, because they'll answer you. Uh-huh. That's all you'll ever get, but they'll answer that. But if you want more, if you want that handhold, okay, or you want to watch twins being born, you're going to have to put in more effort than that.
Oh my gosh, we've got to hear about that.
Watch twins being born.
Yeah, and so when I go out, when I could travel myself, I had a routine. I had my folding chair, my Kindle, and my ice chest. And I'd open up my chair, sit my butt down in it, open up my Kindle, reach in my ice chest, grab a cold Diet Pepsi and a cold chicken hip and a boiled egg, and there I'd sit.
I was going to say, for a younger generation watching, an ice chest is a cooler, by the way. But so tell me, Tom, I've got, and this is. Because I've got one that I interact with off and on. And there might be more than one. I think there might be a couple of them, but we have interactions off and on, but never a visual, but I'm always with,
as you can see, I'm always prepared.
Yeah. I'm always with 2-4 people or more with me at the time. And I would like to get it to the next level to where I've got a face-to-face, or maybe mm-hmm. not quite the handhold, but I'd be willing to do that. Do I need to just do that alone? Do I need to go up alone
and just
do it by myself and get the mm-hmm. others away and just be, because they know who I am.
We were in Georgia in camp, the camp I was telling you about in Georgia, and there were 18 of us sitting around a fire. And all of a sudden, the lady directly across the fire from me, she'd never seen one. I look up and her lower lip is starting to quiver. She's pointing right at me. So I did that, looked back over my head. There's two of them standing right behind me at the fire.
Oh my gosh.
But they came in and exposed themselves to 18 people, though, apparently. So
one of whom was a Superior Court magistrate in Georgia. So
okay.
If people want to call us liars, they've got some high-powered people to be calling liars.
Wow. Yeah.
Tom, was that Georgia gathering chapter you had in your other book?
Yeah.
I was reading about that mm-hmm. earlier, and it was very interesting because you described you just sat around the fire just like you would, like, much like Mike describes.
Well, we do that. We'll go up and we'll build a fire and gather around and just sit and we'll talk and we'll crunch mm-hmm. on potato chips or popcorn and drink some. I drink coffee, whatever your drink choice is. And we got them to where they're coming within 25, 30 yards, but staying in the tree line.
Mm-hmm. And 99% of the time, especially when you have more than one or two people, they'll do that. If you're there alone, they get curious why you're sitting there alone.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I discovered that back in the 1970s when I was doing forestry work, and I'd have to hike in to do a bridge site, and I'd do all the measurements. And before I left, I'd sit down and draw it up because I hated to get back home and start drawing up the bridge and find out I'd forgotten to get one measurement and have to hike back in 6 or 7 miles to get it.
Gosh.
And it was when I was doing that, there's a whistle they do. It's just a, pardon me, I'm not a great whistler.
Right.
But it's just an up-down whistle. If you listen to the Sierra sounds, it's on track 7. You'll hear that whistle.
Right.
And then I look up and look around pretty quick. I see an eyeball peeking around the tree at me. I thought for a long time that they only had one eye and it just shifted from side to side.
Like a cyclops.
Yeah. It just went from one side to the other. But that's what they do. And that whistle, which is basically, I've got him in sight here. And the first time I heard that howl, that was in Northern California. And I had trailed one for, 5-6 hours. And finally got dark on me. I was down the bottom of the canyon and decided to camp there. And I think that's probably in that book too, Peggy.
Yes.
And I heard one call behind me and then another one call over here. And I knew they were communicating, but like I said, I just thought it was like shooting a flare. I'm over here, I've got him in sight type thing. But no, that's looking at the spectral analysis, that's conversation. They are conversing.
Wow.
They're talking to each other, and it sounds like I need to increase my level of bravery.
Yeah.
He has a girlfriend. She's a Sasquatch, and he has a girlfriend. She only communicates with him.
Well, that is true, because there will be a handful of us out there, Tom, and she will answer me, but she won't answer anybody else.
Absolutely. I had the mother of the twins in Canada, in BC, was a young lady, very unique. The only blue-eyed one I've ever seen.
Huh.
Oh, wow.
And then my teacher's daughter is a redhead. I guess you'd say a red-bodied.
Yeah.
But I took Alex Evans with me there one time. And the only time I ever saw Taranika is when she was hiding behind her father, peeking out around his legs. She was only about 9, 10 at the time. And she was so excited because here was a human woman with the same color hair she had. That was pretty darn cute.
let me ask you this, because this did happen, and with the quote unquote girlfriend that Susan mentions, on two separate occasions, we were going back and forth, she and I going back and forth. And I mean, we're talking into the 10-minute mark by this point, and two or three other guys sitting there in the group, fascinated by it. They'd try to say something, she wouldn't answer them. I'd talk, she'd answer. They'd talk, she wouldn't answer. Finally, one of our partners clicked on his recorder for his iPhone to record. And as soon as he clicked on his recorder, she shut down completely. Two times, back-to-back weeks, that happened. And I'm thinking, okay, well, she's had enough playfulness for the evening, and she's going on to do other things. And then after the second time, he mentioned to me what he had done the last two times. He goes, it's crazy how she's done that as soon as I hit the record button on my iPhone. Now, can they pick things up like that or sense things, or do we just not know that? I mean, I don't know.
Ask Becky about Richard Stuart Taylor and his.
He was the one with the gun, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And that gun had never been out of his pocket.
I think the answer is obvious. It happened two times. Yes, they can sense it.
Yeah. Yeah, they amaze me. You know, people said, oh, you know, multidimensional. I don't even know what that means. But yeah. I do know they are a flesh and blood being, but they have some capabilities that will blow you right flat out of the water.
I think that's the best way to describe it. The best way to describe it. And that's crazy. So
I have trailed them across a snowfield, get out in the middle of the field on the track stop, just disappear.
I've heard that. Yeah.
And you've done that. You've trailed them and came up to that. And there's no viable explanation for it at that point.
At the other end of that spectrum, I sat there and watched tracks appearing with nothing making them.
Yeah. Wow. I've heard of that. Mm-hmm. Oh my goodness, that is amazing.
I was with Dr. Igor Burtsev and another fellow at that time, and I had put out a bag of apples and going to sit in the car. That Igor and the other fellow had gone for a walk up the creek bottom, and I was just sitting in my car going to write for a while and put those apples out so they could have them if they wanted them. And all of a sudden I was sound asleep. I woke up, I looked, and I had put out 22 apples. There was 5 left.
There. Oh my goodness. And you were, they just, okay, he's going to go to sleep and I'm going to have some dessert.
We're going to leave some for Tom in case he wakes up hungry.
Yeah. I think they're the reason I went to sleep, to be truthful, because I'd had a good night's sleep in just 2 hours before. So yeah, I walked over to the edge of the bank and looked down across the little swale there, and there were the 2 sets of footprints appearing as they went across there.
Wow.
Wow. That's amazing. Wow. Can you answer a question talking about the gentleman that the Bigfoot asked him, why do you have a gun? Is that what you were talking about?
Yeah.
Okay. And then at one point, the Bigfoot mind speaks, I guess, to him and says, step away from, I think it was
Arla. Step away from Arla, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Step away from Arla. Mm-hmm. Was that, I kind of got lost in that. Was that so he could take him and show him something?
No, I just wanted to talk to him by himself.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was only, Arla was no more than 15, 20 feet away. Just step away from her.
Right.
Arla's my mentor. She lives in southeastern Oklahoma.
Right.
And she has them on her place. Those were on her place. And if you'd have talked to Stuart before that time about MindSpeak, he'd have told you that you needed to see a psychiatrist.
Well, I would have said the same thing until
anybody that hears voices needs to see a psychiatrist.
Right. When I started reading your book last year and we talked about it on the program a little bit, then I started kind of studying it up and I thought, well, there are no instances in which that probably took place. I think the first one that came to my mind was with Samuel, when he thought it was Eli that was talking to him and he was hearing the voice of God and in the Bible, probably through mind speak at that point. And then it was a donkey that verbalized to the prophet Balak at one point in the Old Testament. And that, you know, so when you start putting two and two together, you think there are things out there that people can experience that not everybody does.
Well, yeah. So, and we've all got received testimony of the Holy Ghost.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
I used Cliff Barrickman was a great one for this one. You know, mind speak is nothing more than wishful thinking coupled with the, with self-talk. And so I tell him the story about when I was coming back from little town near where I lived, a friend lived there and I'd gone there for dinner. Coming back, it was February, late February and late at night, rainy. And all of a sudden I see there's a long straight stretch of, that's the old highway, just absolutely straight for several miles there. And I see this set of headlights come up behind me at a really high rate of speed. I mean, like 80, 90 mile an hour. Mm. So I just pulled over and let him go by. And as I started to pull back out on the road again, that voice said, slow down, he's not going to make the curve.
Oh.
So I just eased off. And believe me, the last thing I want to do was go around that curve. because there were, I mean, there were four high school kids in up there.
Wow.
Returning home from a basketball game in this little town of Tenino. And, but it was fortunate they had spun out, but they just spun out in the infield on the on-ramp to the interstate and wow. didn't roll or anything, just scared the daylights out of themselves. Wow. And, oh but God. I stopped there and it was so raining so much. It was so wet. They couldn't get out of there. So I went across the way after I made sure everybody was all right and called a wrecker for them. But, you know, I just show me where the, you know, the wishful thinking was in that.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Because the last thing I want to do is go around that curve. And, but I've got three or four of that type of instances.
Oh, yeah. We all have those right. stories.
Yeah.
Which kind of indicates there's something to that. And,
yeah. My teacher speaks to me all the time. It's just the same thing, only a different voice.
Right.
Right.
And believe me, he's not shy about letting me know what he wants done. a couple of years ago, I decided I was finished writing books, and I forgot to run that by him first. So three more later.
Now, when you say your teacher,
his name is Akinesha.
Okay.
He stands 9'3" tall, yeah, weighs about 970 pounds.
Yeah, that's what I was getting at. Just to clarify who we're talking about there.
Yeah.
So.
I met him on a road. And again, Arla figured that. Arla is a shaman. She hates for me to say that, but it's true. I've been, when I still lived in Eastern Washington in the desert, I had called a paramedics one time. My heart was acting up and it was getting bad. So I called the paramedics. I'm on the gurney, headed out the door, and my phone rings. And it's Arla in Oklahoma. Who are those people? What's wrong with you? And who are those people there with you?
I remember that, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so I explained. And she's done that to me several times. And I was getting ready to go get out. It was in September of 2010. And I just wanted to get away from town and out in the woods for a while. And I'd talked to Arla about it. And she says, this place you're going, is there a stack of wood on that road? I said, I don't know. I said, to be truthful, I've never been on this road. I've been on the top of the ridge on both sides. But this particular road goes right up the river bottom. And the land was deeded from a timber company to the Indian reservation, and they've had it closed while they were rebuilding the road and graveling it and everything, and they just opened it back up to the public, and that's why I wanted to go in there, because I'd never been in there. She says, well, I see a stack of wood of logs, and there's a large dark male with a red stripe on his chest looking over the top at him for you. I said, well, I'll make that easy. I'll drive up that road until if I see a stack of wood, that's where I'll stop. I did. And I was there till about 2 p.m. And that voice came. I can't come out. There's been too much traffic today. And I just it really frustrated me because it was Saturday, but it didn't have to be Saturday. I'm right. retired. It could have been Monday. It could have been Wednesday. That, day of the week meant nothing to me. I says, would it be better than if I left and come back another day? He says, that probably would be better. So I loaded everything back in my car, my folding chair, my
what do you call it?
Ice chest. Yeah. Didn't want to confuse people. And I had one leg in the car under the steering wheel, and was just starting to squat down to get in. And he stood up right across the road from me, about 12 feet away. And he said, I wanted you to see me before you left. And he does. He's got a red stripe, runs from the point of his shoulder here down across his body to above his hip here. And he's got three black lines tattooed over his nose. He's got a crescent moon and a star tattooed on his shoulder. And it's, you know, Indian type tattoos where you just poke it, break right. skin, and then press charcoal in it. That type of tattoo. The red stripe looked like it probably was a berry juice type stain. And he said that's a mark of his status within their clan.
Okay.
May set him aside as a teacher. And so then from there on, we've had an ongoing relationship. And the things he's done have amazed me. The healings he's done have amazed me. I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for him and the things he's done. But yeah, it's been quite a ride.
One thing I
want you to know is lose all fear. There is nothing to fear from these beings. As long as you don't disrespect them, they will show you no disrespect. The fact they throw pebbles that big at you means nothing. They hunt with rocks. If they wanted to hurt you, they could do it so bad.
We have evidence that they hunt with rocks, and mm-hmm. I don't want to get hit by one of the rocks that I've seen that they hunt with, but
no.
I did have one throwing hickory nuts at me one night, and mm-hmm. I kind of felt like that was kind of just a playful messing around type thing.
Usually that's kids doing that.
But one of the guys I was with didn't think that so much, and I think got a little bit too excited and scared him off a little bit. But but I have to get braver. I have to go up and do it alone and see what happens. Yeah. I got to figure that out, Tom. But I tell you what, hold the book up one more time. The proof is out there. We spent the first two-thirds of the program talking about the things that are in this book that will be released hopefully later on in November. TomCantrell.com.
The book is done.
The
book is done. I'm just in the process now of getting it to the printer and, getting it. And what I'm having trouble with is converting from DocX file to PDF file and having it maintain all of its attributes.
So you can go to www.TomCantrell.com. and order it, and I will get a link in the when we release the program. I'll put a link to the website in that release, and I guess it's also probably available on Amazon as well. But
it will be available on Amazon. It'll be available on the website tomorrow or the next day as soon as I get done with the
okay. TomCantrell.com. We'll get that when we release the program. We'll put that in access to a link to the website on that. I plan on getting me a copy of it, and I know
don't forget to get my Christmas present, Mike.
And there you go. There you go. So
I'm your sister from another mother.
Both of you. Merry Christmas to both of you. Just check your stockings. So we got you covered, Susan. So anyway, Sean. We'll cover you as well. So we'll get all that taken care of. So Sean produces the program. Tom, it's been a pleasure having you with us again. And you're a great guest, and you have great connections in this community. And we learn more. I thought we've had this the third time we've had you on the program. And I can't speak for these two ladies, but I thought, can we learn more from Tom than what we learned already? Of course, we did tonight immensely.
Yes. Well, we don't get to talk about everything all the time. You know?
That's true. That's true. Right.
But we should do a class every week, and you're the teacher. Yes.
And you brought up the first two shows he was on. So,
and you brought up a couple of things tonight that we've got to come back on and talk about again sometime. So,
Well, I've been doing this for 65 years, so I should have learned something.
You should know something about that. So, anyway, Tom, it's great having you. We love you.
Thank you all very much. It's been wonderful.
And hopefully we can work it out and get a conversation, if not a show, with your buddy Bob sometime in the near future as well, because we really, truly respect his story and the things that he went through in life to stand by that, to really open the door up for this whole community to kind of evolve in the last 15 or so mm-hmm. years. So we really appreciate that as well.
You know, the weekend before Thanksgiving, I don't know yet for sure, but Bob is planning on being with me out at Ocean Shores for the Sasquatch Summit.
Okay.
And maybe we could pull an hour free from that.
If anything, pull an hour free. If anything, yeah. If Sean's free, mm-hmm. if he's not free, we can just get on this format and talk. Just tell him how much we appreciate it.
Call me.
All right.
You'll be available, right, Susan?
See, I lost out again.
Again before Thanksgiving.
Weekend before Thanksgiving.
We will not put you number two. We knew you first.
I was out at the summit one time, and Bob was standing there as usual, with six or seven ladies around him. I said, "Bob, I had a desire, need to see a pretty girl, and I knew in order to do that, I was going to have to find you."
Well, I'll tell you, that's crazy. Tom, we appreciate you so much. And Susan and Becky, thanks for stopping by and sharing it with Tom.
Yeah, good to be here.
John, we appreciate what you do, producing the show. Sean Seaball, host of the Kayak Flyer. Right. If you're into fishing, check his podcast out. Mm-hmm. Guys, it's been a great evening. Until next time, we'll see you on Understanding Bigfoot. Thank you, Tom.
Good night.